Zach Kaplan founded Inventables in 2002, and since then he has shared his vision at conferences all over the country, including the main stage of TED. Please join me in welcoming Zach Kaplan.
Wow, thank you. First of all, before I get started tonight, I want to thank Kristen for this amazing group of people, this amazing event. Everybody, and actually meet everybody in person, because I've seen all of you on YouTube before, but not many people in real life. So Kristen started yesterday, which almost seems like a week ago, with this quote. She said, "If you do what you love, you won't work a day in your life." And so as I was standing out there listening to her say that, I was thinking like, wow, people talk about work as a place that you don't want to go. But you guys talk about work as a thing that you love doing. So I was thinking about from my own journey as a maker, where did this start? Why do I love doing this stuff? And it really started in this picture, in this room. So this is the machine shop at my high school. And I spent the better part of 4 years in high school working in this room. And in high school, my friends didn't work in the machine shop. They didn't do digital manufacturing. They didn't think it was very cool. So I was a bit of an outcast when it came to this kind of stuff, but I loved it. And it stayed with me every year. And there were really two things that I got out of this class that stay with me today. The first was just the love of making stuff. I'm a guy who loves to make stuff. And the second was the community that the teacher would build around this class created. Because it didn't matter, the class was called SciTech, it didn't matter if we were doing a contest where there were six teams, you were competing, but everybody helped each other. It didn't matter if you were good or bad, everybody always helped. And that's just like the people in this room, everybody helps each other. And so later in life, like that class really inspired me to start Inventables and get involved in making professionally. And later, like 2000, I believe it was 13, I saw this video. It was Bob, and he had just started his channel. At the time, he didn't have a beard, which is a little weird if you look at Bob now. Thinking back to the day that he didn't have a beard. But also, he worked at Dell. This wasn't a full-time thing for Bob, and he had about 24,000 subscribers. And I saw this, and the name of his channel, I like to make stuff, and I was like, I like to make stuff! And I was like, wow, this guy made his video channel around making stuff. That's so cool. So we reached out to Bob, and we gave him our first machine, and about 9 months later, he actually grew a beard, apparently. And he did a review video of one of the machines that we made. And so I've actually never said this next part to anybody. I've never said the words out loud, but after watching this video, and I had a conversation with Bob on the phone, I hung up, I was sitting in my office, I'm looking out the window, and I remember thinking, oh man, so are we working with just Bob? Should we work with other people on YouTube, like Bob's competitors? I was really kind of nervous about it, thinking, you don't have your TV show on NBC and NBC, you pick one. I never said it to Bob, and I've never actually said it to anybody else out loud, but I was like kind of scared and like, hey, like, are we gonna really screw over Bob by working with someone else? Bob didn't think that way. So he had this program on his channel called Brain Pick. And I remember one of the first people on Brain Pick was Steve Carmichael. And now, like, obviously, like, this room has gone from maybe a handful of people to this room now exists, and there's literally hundreds of people making videos on YouTube about all different things. And YouTube has gone from a million creators to 50 million creators. But these people are just a few of the people in this room who are making videos for themselves. And so his approach to this whole thing was not that he was in competition with Jimmy DiResta, even though that would be kind of funny. But he was collaborating with Jimmy DiResta. So over the course of the weekend, a number of you have come up to me, and if you've never heard of Inventables, you ask, what the hell is Inventables? And if you have heard of Inventables, you said, what's next for Inventables? What's your vision? So I thought I'd spend a second here and talk to you a little bit about what we are and what our vision is. So we make a couple of 3D carving machines and some software called Easel. And our approach to this was we're trying to make it as easy and accessible as possible. We want as many people participating in these kinds of projects as possible. We don't want to limit you by how much it costs. We don't want to limit you by technical ability or background. And so, with each of these products, the Carvey, it's really designed for schools and libraries. And we gave away one machine to a school in every state, so as many kids could have free access as possible. With the X-Carve, it's about $1,500. There's three sizes. It really fits in a garage. And we gave away one to a makerspace in every state to get as much access as possible. Right now, you can go to inventables.com/maps, and there's about 1,400 publicly accessible machines. And Easel is free. You just have to go to easel.com, and you can sign up to get access. And so we think about Easel as a platform. So our partners from Autodesk are here, and they make some cool software called Fusion 360. And so for us, it's really cool to have partners like Autodesk and Vectric, because we're not trying to make Easel versus Fusion 360 or Easel versus V-Carve. We're trying to say, hey, it's a platform. Let's get the right tool for the job. So what we're seeing, when we started, most of our customers were hobbyists. They were out there to have fun. They were out there just to kind of explore their passions. Over the last 9 months, a segment of our customers that we really didn't have much of before has grown massively, and that is people starting businesses. They're not traditional manufacturers. They're guys like this. This is Casey, and they turn their garage into a factory. Some of the next question I typically get is like, okay, so people have these garages and they're making these products. What kind of products do they make? So I'm going to share three products or projects that were made for people in this room. The first one is from Dylan Casey at Woodbrew. It's a really cool chair. And he used one sheet of plywood in an interesting pattern technique to bend it up. I saw this, I was like, wow, that's really cool. The second is Steve Carmichael. Let's give him a round of applause. So prior to this video, lots of people made signs. Signs. We even had people calling us up and saying, so tell me about your sign maker. Okay, it's not a sign maker. So Steve made this video, and then we said, well, yeah, you can make a guitar. There's this guy down in Georgia who just did it in his garage. People are like, you can make a guitar on that thing? I'm like, yeah, check out this video. Blew people's mind. And then this last one, it just happened last week. So Ben Rita, he took two X-Carves, he flew them out to California, he set them up, and this is a retail store that he's building out for a new shoe company called Greats. They're making sort of a showcase or a store that is a destination, an experience. They're clearly not concerned with packing in as many shoes as possible. They're concerned with making an experience that you can Instagram. And so when Ben was talking about this to me, he said, you know, we took two X-Carves, We set them up. We had 20 days. We carved all the material, painted it, and installed it. And we only charged them $50,000. I was like, wow, how much would it have cost if they would have gone a conventional route? And he said, I don't know, maybe $100,000 for the architecture firm and the design firm, and another $100,000 for the contract manufacturer, the general contractor, and the carpenters, and the painters, and et cetera, and all the materials. When you look at what he's done here, he said that he did the design on his laptop, on the floor, here. So he had been working on it in his head. He opened up Illustrator, he did some designs, and then they had two X-Carves running 8 hours a day, 10 or 15 days in a row, and then they did the install. In 20 days! So somebody in one of the earlier talks said, oh, he probably should have charged more. Which, maybe so. But what Ben said is, they liked it so much, they asked him, they're probably going to ask him to do 3 or 4 more stores. And each one is going to be a little bit unique, even though it's in the same style. With traditional tools, making each one unique would have been more complicated. But with digital tools, you just change the file. So, not all of our customers have YouTube channels. And not all of them are doing all of these creative projects. This is Debbie, and she was an accountant for 30 years. And she had been doing woodworking as a hobby with her husband on the weekend. They live up in Canada. I noticed there's a lot of Canadians here. Hey, apparently, woodworking is really big in Canada. A lot of trees. So, Debbie actually lost her job as an accountant and was trying to think, man, what should I do next? Should I get another accounting job? Should I do something else? And the Canadian government has a program where if you lose your job and you want to start a company, they give you a certain amount of seed capital and a certain amount of months that you can get going. So she went on our site, and she was looking at all the different options. She drove to some of the factories where they make much bigger machines, like 4-foot by 8-foot machines. She built a spreadsheet, narrowed it down, and what she was focused on was the amount of time it would take to pay back the cost of the machine. Because this was a new venture for her, she didn't know if they were going to actually be able to make money. And they had done things by hand, but she calculated that she couldn't make a living doing it all by hand, because you couldn't do it fast enough. So she ended up going with the smallest X-Carve we have. This is our least popular product. It's just about $1,000. And she said she did it because the payback period was the shortest. And she optimized her product to fit in that area because she didn't want to risk an extra $500. The interesting part is I flew up to Canada to go meet Debbie, and I asked her, how did you find out about Inventables all the way up here in Canada? Like, did you know somebody or did you see one of our ads? And she said, oh no, I saw it on YouTube. You guys have a bunch of people who have made stuff with this X-Carve, and after watching a bunch of those videos, I thought, maybe I could do it too. And so I wanted everybody in this room today to really understand what you're doing is way more important than just making content, or just getting a sponsorship, or just making a chair. You're impacting the lives of lots of people who don't have YouTube channels, and inspiring them to start businesses. It used to be that less than 10% of people who ordered from us started a business. Now, more than half of the people buying X-Carves are starting or running a business. Some of them are making a few $1,000s, some of them are having a side hustle, some of them it's a part-time job, and some of it's their full-time job. We have people now who are making as much money at their day job as they're making off their X-Carve. And they had to have this awkward debate with their spouse. Honey, can I quit? Absolutely not. And so I've talked to a couple of these people, and I said, why does your spouse think you shouldn't quit? And they say the same thing every time. My spouse does not believe the orders will continue when I quit my job. I've heard that once, I was like, yeah. I heard it twice. It is consistent. And it's not until people are making 1.5 or 2 times their salary that their spouse is like, okay, fine, quit. So Debbie is making signs for the most part. They also make some furniture. But there's some key things that we're seeing with people. They're either who are making real money. They're either making something that's custom, like a sign, or they're making something that is super special and niche, like a toy for Montessori education. It's not just Canada. We now have customers all over the world. And what we're excited about is not that it's this many customers, but rather that last year they did over 1 million carves, and this year they're on pace to do over 2 million. It's growing at 100% year over year. And in large part, you guys are doing this. Because without you, we're just selling machines. But you're inspiring people to get out there and take a risk and make a business or make extra income. You're inspiring people to do something. And that inspires me. It used to be Bob and Jimmy. If you think about today versus tomorrow, all of those tiles are going to be filled up with other people in this room and people who aren't in this room. YouTube had 1 million creators when Bob started, and now they're at 50 million. This is just the beginning of what's going on. I've been working in Inventables for 15 years, and I think today marks the beginning of the next chapter. I was looking at Bob's subscriptions, and he now has 1.6 million subscribers watching him make stuff. In 10 years, Bob will probably have 10 million subscribers, and a lot of you will have 1 million or 2 million. That's a lot of videos, and that's a lot of people that will be watching those videos, making businesses, making new projects, and coming up with stuff that we haven't even thought of. In Austin, Texas, these two guys, Tom and Dan, started a company called Studio Neat, and they make a stand for the Apple TV remote. Because if you have an Apple TV remote, and I see some of you do, you know that it always falls in between the couch cushions because Apple made it so skinny you can't see it. So these guys have an extremely niche and custom audience that they understand. They don't make consumer electronic accessories. They make products that are lifestyle products for their niche. They got started on Kickstarter, and they have a small, tight community of maybe 5,000 to 10,000 people who love them. So I emailed them and asked, how many of these little stands for the Apple TV remote have you sold? And he's like, oh, well, they sell them for 15 bucks. He's like, in the first week that we put it up, we sold 1,000. And since then, we've sold about another 2,500. So 3,500 overall. And I was like, so how do you think about that? And he's like, that's great. We don't ever want to have employees. We love that we can come up with an idea, prototype it, share it with our community, ship them out to a third-party logistics place, have a Shopify website, they click cart, or they click buy, and then the 3PL just sends them the product. So you can get basically next-day shipping from these guys, just like Amazon, even though they're operating out of their garage. That's amazing. We have another customer called Sensory Play, and they make toys for Montessori education. These are super specific toys. You would not find these in a place like Toys R Us, or even KB Toys, or any mainstream toy store. So what's happening is, there's about 300,000 factories in the United States. None of those factories would make these toys. What I believe is happening is factories like these are starting up, and over the next decade, it's gonna grow to 3 million factories. It's gonna 10x where we are today. It's not gonna replace the 300,000, it's just gonna be on top. Because they're introducing things that don't exist, like Ben's store and these toys. We're moving from a time in the 1950s and 60s in this country when we as a society and as a culture had a DIY culture. People built radios, people built refrigerators, people built TVs, and sometimes they paid more for the TV in the kit than the one that was at Sears. And then in the 80s and 90s, it all changed. And it was like cost, disposable products. All the manufacturing went to China or low-cost countries. And when we were done with something, we threw it out. We threw it out. And that was okay. I think we're at the beginning of going back to a time when that DIY culture is coming back. And I think that the people in this room are bringing it back. It's not about, yeah. This is not about us versus China. This is about us helping us. So let's bring DIY back. Thank you.
Thank you.
One moment, please.
So I got really excited. I forgot to give away the X card. So the person on the sheet of paper, sorry about that. So when we were preparing to come to WorkbenchCon, Mo and Maura, they had like been brainstorming and they were like super excited, like, we've got to go to WorkbenchCon. I'm like, what the hell is WorkbenchCon? And she's like, oh, it's like all these YouTube people, it's really cool. I was like, all right, we always tell all the YouTubers we need more engagement. So how are you guys gonna give more engagement to all the YouTubers to kind of, so we're showing rather than telling? And they're like, So they came up with this idea that we were gonna run a contest to design something on the easel before and then carve them out here, and then everybody would vote on who gets to win an X-Carve. And Mo came back after that stroke of brilliance and was like, Zach, I don't think we're gonna have time to carve out all the projects at WorkbenchCon, so I'm just gonna come in on the weekend and do them. So she came in last weekend and like basically spent the whole weekend carving all the projects, and one guy's like took like 8 hours and it didn't work. But he didn't win. So in the booth, she had all the projects lined up and people were voting with screws. So we'd like to congratulate John LaFon. Who made the detachable serving tray cup holder. So congratulations.
Thank you. Where are my new welders at? How many of you guys are gonna go back and start talking about how easy welding can be. That's why I'm here. This is exciting for me. So I have a lot of stuff to give away, all gently used, but very viable. I'm gonna need somebody's help up here, I think. Is Fuller still here? First of all, is Brian Fuller? Fuller?
Yeah.
Fuller, I need your help. First of all, give Brian Fuller a hand, please. Local boy, done good. So we're gonna do a drawing here. Fuller's gonna be my, the give up. You're gonna be my girl Friday, sorry. All right, we've got several welding helmets. We'll start with the first one, going to Mortgage and Miter. Assistant Brian, can I help you out? Second welding helmet going to Sam Ryan Designs. Yeah, that's exciting. The third helmet's going to Sam Raimondi. Get to know nature. And I think we're down to one more, Spencer Stevens.
All right, one more.
Derby Outdoor is a 40-volt brushless push mower. Lori Foswick.
Okay.
All right, y'all, that is the end of WorkBenchcon.